can actually see how the players got to this point if we see the group they played in, because even the group itself, as we mentioned earlier, when we went through Group B, we did say there were two world champions in this one. As you can see now, Firebat did lose to JJ in the first round, and Oskaka took down Zyrez. And then we can see now as we're going to go Super JJ versus Oskaka first, and then later on we're going to see Zyrez, who did beat out Firebat in the lower bracket, go against the loser of this match for that final chance at the spot in the top eight tomorrow. But this is just a super stacked group, and there's kind of, you know, surprising results already, but someone has to get knocked out, right? That's the that's the problem with stacked groups. Someone has to go, even though you don't really know who to pick.
Well, when you have three superstars in one group and you're aware that only two guys will go through, then most likely one of the superstars will be already out, right?
Yeah, exactly.
But in Zyrez as well, he's one of these guys, you know, the fourth player in the group, and like he's good enough to lead most groups. He just is a really good deck builder and constructor. Mm-hmm. He's well known on the scene. He does well in these tournaments. Yet to have a breakout, but in most groups he would be like one of the main players. In this group he's like the fourth guy, like feel a bit sorry for him.
Yeah, I think Zyrez is like one of the players that all the pros know who he is and speak quite highly of him, yet he's not really, as you said, had the huge breakout performance too much. He's just always sort of there and just waiting for that moment, but definitely capable, and you know, taking down Firebat is no mean feat in itself, so he does have a chance later on today. But Oskaka versus JJ, yeah. I mean, I kind of wish I was sat where you were so I could cast the game, but I'm definitely going to enjoy watching it. And now we can see the players just waiting to start the game. Now we have JJ on Warlock, Shaman, Druid, and Warrior, which is banned to no one's surprise. And Oskaka on the Mage, Shaman, Druid, Warrior as well. So we've seen a lot of Shaman, Druid, Warrior comps. And then we're just with like an additional sort of style class choice that we see. Like, what do you make of the bans coming across here, Lorinda?
I mean, like you say, it's no surprise to anyone to ban Warrior. For one thing, their deck lists are hidden. So you're banning like a lot of things in your mind. It just takes away that mysterious factor, as well as it's probably just the best class right now. Most lineups revolve around the Warrior.
Well, is it, right? Because in my eyes currently, Druid is just wrecking everyone, mm-hmm. you know? And that's a problematic class as well, because it doesn't have as much archetypes as Warrior has, right? But it's still sick.
Yeah, it doesn't matter, right? You just go innovate into good things and win games. Exactly. Yeah, you're right.
Yep, so we are starting the match now. So Lorinda and Lothar, take it away.
Thank you, Raven. So we're starting the second match of the day with a Tunnel Trog opener, which is always amazing to see. But Oskaka is actually playing a Freeze Mage.
Right, which is, I mean, something that Oskaka does, but you do see Freeze Mage in tournaments a bit, especially in last year standing, but opening with it, what do you think? Like, you're risking running into that Shaman early on.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, you have one good matchup, which is Zoo, right?
Yep.
And I'm guessing that Oskaka made some research. What was JJ playing in the Swiss, right? So he's aware that JJ was playing Zoo. He most likely didn't change it for the Swiss for the playoffs portion. So he still has really one good matchup. But Shaman is not really that great. I would say it's favoring the Shaman like 60-40, maybe a little bit more. Right.
I've heard some of the pros say if you get the Doomsayer in your opening hand, then you can make this a 50-50. How do you see that? Do you think that's a thing? Or
I think it's impacting the board a lot and the game state.
How about if you get two Doomsayers in your opening hand? How's that?
That is sick. Right? The thing is, Shaman is so oversaturated with good cards that cards like F-Shock, which normally would have been an auto-inclusion in almost every single deck, is just doesn't have you don't have space for that. And it's such an amazing card, right? It deals damage to a minion, it silences the buffs, it gets rid of taunt, it's just cancelling the effect from Doomsayer, and still it's not being played.
So JJ will know that there's a Doomsayer in Oskaka's hand, because you hard mulligan for Doomsayer in this matchup, right? You just go for the
card.
And he kept a card.
That card can also be a Frostbolt.
Okay.
Right? Because I feel like when you're playing out the Freeze Mage, you probably want to keep the Frostbolt, because if there's one Tunnel Trog that just goes off,
you
probably will lose.
So that makes JJ's decision really difficult. If he wants to play the Tunnel Trog and develop the board around a Frostbolt, then that would be, you know, both minions. But if he wants to play just around the Doomsayer, he just develop one minion and play a little bit carefully here.
I mean, he is an out against the Doomsayer if he just coins out of his session this turn, but it's losing damage, right? But then he has the Flametongue Totem for the upcoming turn, which will be amazing. But I don't see that happening in any game unless you're like 100% sure that the opponent has a Doomsayer.
Right, and yeah, we just see him here doing nothing crazy, just taking his time. Obviously, he's just going to make that totem, make his thing from below cheaper, hit for one, and just have to pass sadly back.
Yeah. What if you actually would make that call and just play the really risky thing? Just go with Abusive Surgeon, Internal Trigger on turn one, and then Flame Tongue Totem just to kill the Doomsayer.
You want to Lava Burst this? It keeps your one guy on the board. It's going to be a 3-3.
And you have Abusive Surgeon on turn three, right? That's, yeah. That doesn't sound bad.
You don't know there's another Doomsayer coming.
Yeah. Well,
no.
He doesn't go for it. Let's see how that will develop for Osaka. I feel like he probably will just go with the Loot Holder anyway. I don't feel like you need to play the Doomsayer on turn three when you're aware that your opponent can still he won't have anything really in particular powerful on turn three. Like, Pharaoh Spirit is probably the best thing you can play on turn three, apart from Tuskator Dynamic. But if there's nothing like that in the opponent's hand, then the Doomsayer is kind of
thrown
out of the window, right?
Yeah, he's just got to develop this and see how he ends up. And people say that Shaman is like easy to play or brain dead because it's an aggro deck. He's having to make a huge decision every single turn in this match. How much risk do I want to take against this Freeze Mage? If you don't take enough risks, you don't kill them in time. If you take too many, you get wiped out. So he's treading this really fine line every turn.
This is also a very interesting turn because I was thinking there are basically three options, right? You can go Loot Holder Pink. You can go Novice Engineering Ping, you can go Doomsayer Ping. And in my eyes, I would go probably Loot Holder Ping, because of the fact that Loot Holder is a delayed effect, drawing the card, so you buy the draw as soon as possible, especially when your opponent still has only one minion on board and not that a lot of pressure on board, right?
Right.
The Doomsayer is really powerful with Frost Nova at some point, and you lost two Doomsayers now. Basically gained a lot because of that one Doomsayer that was played in turn two, right? But now the Frost Novas have lost a lot of value.
Right, now they just sort of stall for a turn. They don't even stall the face if he has the Doomhammer. We can see he has that. And JJ can start going to work here on actually doing what Shaman's supposed to be doing and reducing that life total rapidly before the Freeze Mage gets set up. And Osaka's hand is not really the hand he'd desire right now. He'd be looking for more draw, more bits of the combo, more damage, and he's kind of got a bit of a mess of a hand right now.
But it's still not terrible. He has a Blizzard to follow up. And then after Blizzard, he might even stall with the Frost Nova because he has the follow-up with the Blizzard, right? So this is not terrible.
But yeah, he's not dying anytime soon with that hand. But
yeah.
And that's what Freeze Mage does, of course. Just buys itself more and more time. But yeah, JJ's probably going to start getting to work about now.
So now, do you want to push for most amount of damage that you can dish out this turn, which would be the Flaming Totem, because also you are mana efficient at the same time. But then your opponent, let's say your opponent has the Blizzard, right? Super JJ has no idea if that's in his opponent's hand.
Right.
There was no way of reading that out from the way the game was unfolding. So I would say if he has the Blizzard and you go for the Flaming Totem, you lose the entire board just because of that. Because you have to deal the face damage, right? Wow, he's going for it. Interesting. He also chose to play the Flaming Totem on the right-hand side instead of the left-hand side, deal more damage this time.
Yep.
So it's interesting to see that because now he's actually... What this thing says is you don't have the Blizzard.
Right, and could he? I mean, I don't think he can. He's one of the best players in the world. But, you know, Osaka has played both Doomsayers quickly. So maybe there is something else in his hand, you know. But on the other side, JJ doesn't have to worry about Frost Nova Doomsayer because they're gone.
Yeah, That's correct. The thing is, like, when your opponent is playing suboptimally with Freeze Mage, an example, when you just play the Doomsayer and it can be killed, I feel like this is not an... Not a telegraphic information for the Shaman, because of the fact that sometimes they just have really bad hands and just need to do something.
And they just have to do it anyway. So it's not it's not telling him. He couldn't pick that up from that. That's good to know. So now Osaka just taking his time. It does seem like Blizzard is the main choice here. I guess he's just making sure. With Freeze Mage, you have so many interesting options. Sometimes you can stall, maybe play the Frost Nova, wait for one more turn and be really greedy. But just, this looks so good. Why not?
That's correct. So for JJ, I feel like you still need to develop the board. But I'm not sure if you want to develop the Dusk Totemic and the First Spirit at the same time. Because there's one Flame Strike.
Right.
In most of the Freeze Mage decks,
right,
there's one Flame Strike. And if you play the Dusk Totemic into Feral Spirit and you lose the roll, oh man, this would be so painful.
Okay, so we can see that at the moment this is a decent judgment. Oskaka can freeze at least one turn. He's going to start drawing cards as well. But at the moment, there's no way of actually getting rid of all this stuff, which is JJ's main concern, because this attacks once, he wins.
Yeah. Well, maybe not.
Yeah, okay. He often wins because of the Doomhammer, etc. Right.
So for Oskaka, the damage in hand is 12, 16, actually. 16 with four cards, so it's not enough to kill his opponent. And he doesn't have Lextraza, so he still has to be on the defensive side. At 7 mana, you can stall a lot of... Actually, you can stall for a really long time with the Ice Barrier, with the Mirror Image, and with one Frost Nova that buys you a really lot of time.
Yeah, and JJ's hand, luckily for JJ, is full of damage, but yeah, Oskaka can gain probably the equivalent of about 20, 25 life just with the 8 from the barrier, the stopped attack. And of course, he's going to draw card every turn, and every card you draw either draws more cards, stops you from dying, or does damage. So he's now getting to the point of the game where if he saw one or two more turns, he will start drawing into the meat of that deck.
Mm-hmm. One Iceland is being used for the Cleansing Totem. I don't blame him for doing that. It will be very problematic for Oskaka to get rid of both at the same time in the coming turns without a Flame Strike, basically.
Important here for JJ, he now has that second Lava Burst, so now in his mind he's only got to do a little bit of damage and he'll get through. There's no ice block yet, so he'd be thinking that, you know, just one more turn, let me get through this.
Let's see. Well, at some point you need to play the ice block, but the problem is you don't have time for that. Maybe this turn? No, you probably want to play Ice Barrier as soon as possible when your opponent has the Doomhammer, because he needs to attack every single turn.
Yeah, you don't want to wait until he can just burn you down. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, that would be a turn, you know, just 8 damage just for nothing if you let him get through.
Yep, that's correct. So Ice Barrier is gonna heal for 8 this turn. Not really doing a lot of stuff for the mage when you consider that just one turn of attacks.
Right, and his hand's now getting small enough that he doesn't really want to use like a fireball to clear something if he has to, because then he starts running out of ways to win, which gives JJ even more time to just keep doing what he's doing. So this is, we're talking about the fine line that the Shaman has to draw, but now Oskaka's got to be so careful not to start losing his win conditions here to stay alive.
Look at that, he actually drew the Roaring Torch from the Forgotten Torch.
Nice.
That was previous turn.
It's a good play, man. Definitely, if you need to do 6 damage, drawing Roaring Torch is important right then.
But does it help him in the big picture? Because
probably
that's the
not.
Question, right? How do you win this game? What is the draw that you need to get this turn to still have a chance to win the entire game? And I don't feel like just a fireball for 3 mana does that.
And he's running out of stuff. Like Arcane Intellect now is almost needed just to get enough different things in his hand. What's he going to do with his hand? 12 damage in hand, sort of 19 if he draws a Frostbolt. Where are you going to get the other 11? You can't play Alexstrasza and Emperor Thoris and all in one turn. Looking really good for JJ here.
True. Doomhammer is a consistent source of damage, although the Icelands can stop one turn of attacks, but still. When you consider the Doomhammer being a 7 mana card that dealt how much damage so far?
Yeah, already it's done
already 12.
Whatever, 12 damage. Yeah.
And it's still 4 damage incoming next turn. That's sick.
16 damage for 5 mana, 7 mana, yeah. That's not bad, right? That's better than Fireball and Roaring Torch.
True that.
And you put it where you want as well. And there's just no realistic way back here. But I've said that about Freeze Mage before, and sometimes they've got ways, but with no cards in your hand, no way to win the game, I don't see how you keep stalling.
So, 2 secrets for Oskaka on the board. That's 10, 14, 16, 18 damage. Not enough to break the ice block this turn.
Right, but
and +2 from air power, but it's still not enough.
So the 7-7 will just make sure that he wins as soon as Oskaka runs out of freezers now. He's going to have to fireball that just to stay alive. In fact, he probably won't even bother, but that's what he'll need to do if he wanted to stay alive, and then you've run out of any sort of damage, as the damage deck, the Freeze Mage, needs to just to win with that, and it's not going to happen.
True. No, a paladin secret.
Wow.
Godolphin.
Change everything.
Yep. It's an eye for an eye. Well, what was the draw? We didn't see it, right?
We didn't see the draw. It bugged out, I think.
Wait, is there anything that can help him here in this situation?
I mean,
I feel that's a
Arcane Intellect is going to be the first card to help him into two good cards, so another barrier and something else.
He used two barriers already.
So another block or another Frost Nova. I think he just dies. I don't think he can draw enough.
Even if you draw the stalls, you have no way of removing the board, so stalling the board doesn't really get you anywhere.
Right.
What you need to do is just kill your opponent right now. Otherwise, you just lose the long-term plan, right? So there's Alexstrasza. And he has Ice Block. So he goes. So Alexstrasza plays. He has... not possible to win, right? Unless he will get Arcane Intellect next turn into Ice Block, into Frostbolt. But he used the Ice Lance. So no more Ice Lances. Rogue Biter from the
top. That sorts out the blocks.
I mean, he didn't need the Rogue Biter, right? Because that's 16 damage for just the Doomhammers and the Lava Burst. So that's 20, 21. So that would have been more than
enough. Flamestrike doesn't do enough because you die. Arcane Intellect into Flamestrike into Block into Fireball.
What?
So Arcane Intellect... you Flamestrike, get some damage through, then you just die. Yeah, you don't think there's a way?
No, I don't think so as well. It looks like
I'm trying to find a way where the Alexstrasza can get through for 8, but I don't think there's a sense.
Even if it goes through for 8, you still need an Ice Block for the next turn, right? Well, again, we don't see the draw. I mean, the spectator is bugging out. Sorry for that, guys. Oh, wait. JJ is still on this turn, never mind. It's just me being stupid.
We want to see the cards in advance.
Yeah.
Make it a bit easier to cast.
Oh!
An Intellect, so okay, if it's going to happen, this is how, right?
That's the Ice Block.
Wow. Can he do anything?
Okay, so if he would be able to play Ice Block and an Emperor this turn...
But he can Fireball Face.
He would have a chance.
He can Fireball Face.
That's 6 damage.
That's 6. And then next turn, if you can Flamestrike and attack with Alexstrasza and ping.
But the opponent will just kill the Alexstrasza instead.
Sure, but if that didn't happen...
True.
But this is Super JJ this we're dealing with. This is not some guy who's 0-3 in the Swiss, so that probably isn't going to happen, but yeah.
So that was the second Ice Block. 2 Ice Barriers gone.
Both Arcane Intellects gone.
Yeah. What's that?
Wow, and it just shows how resilient Freeze Maze is, that even in that situation where he was basically going to lose for a long time, we were still finding ways where, hang on, if he does this, he can actually win the game.
Was it so close?
I mean, as...
if the Shaman would have made mistakes, then maybe, but I feel like an experienced player will not slip that away. Make that slip away from him, right?
I agree. But it was interesting, and he did have the Doomsayer start, so he did have the things that you would want to have, and JJ just managed not to walk into any of the traps. The turn where he really did a lot was where he played the Feral Spirit and the Tuskar. That's one where we thought, if he's got the Flamestrike, this is bad, but he read it right.
Maybe he's not even running the Flamestrike, right?
Maybe not. But they don't know each other's lists, so maybe he just went, you know what, I don't think Oskaka's going to have this or whatever. Mm-hmm. Made the read, stuck them on the table, and carried to the end.
Ooh, I love
and
that.
That's Aviana
Druid. Interesting.
Why not?
So, most likely he will be running Ishar. He will be running as well maybe Deathwing.
Another Deathwing. That'd be 2 in one day we've seen. You saw one in the first match.
There will be a lot of huge minions in this deck.
Idol. Yeah, this is going to be like super ramp, you would imagine. Everything's just going to go into huge things.
And he has a really good opening hand. Living Cruise into Wildgrowth, that's already amazing. Into Mire Keeper, that's sick.
And like you say, he's going to have plenty of things that when he gets to 7-8 mana, they can just do something every turn. JJ's hand is just... I mean, there's no slow hands in his face, Sherman, but slower than normal.
Yeah. I mean, he doesn't have the Flame Totem. That would be the amazing thing when you have 2 Argent Squires in your opening hand. I mean, when you go first and you usually don't want to have 2 Argent Squires.
Right.
Because it's kind of awkward, like, when you play the second one on turn 3, most likely. Right? It's kind of iffy. But,
Sylvanas provides an answer as well here to some of the other stuff. not the worst answer for Druid for 7-7, because Druid doesn't answer things well. It has to use mulch, that sort of thing.
What a card! Melson Portal from the... oh my god. From the top of the deck deals with the problematic living roots and still leaves a huge minion, actually. When you consider this anomaly at least a 2-2, right?
Yeah, because and Shaman likes to tap. Shaman likes to use totems, like use its power. So that thing's going to get big if it's not dealt with now, but Azkaka wants to Wild Growth. You can't just kill this 2-1. If you don't kill it, how do you deal with it?
That is a huge problem, actually. The implications of that Mouse and Portal are just like, holy crap, that's awful for Azkaka. Change the entire plan, but I don't feel like he has any other option than Wild Growth in this.
I agree. But yeah, I mean, we're saying people are probably thinking, oh, it's only a 2-1. What's the problem? But Shaman does a lot of damage. Another 2 or another 4, or this thing might do 8.
Yeah.
That's a lot of damage to worry about.
Correct. I like the decision of just playing Argent Squire with the totem up. Because if you would play the totem golem, then the infamous Flamer of Faceless wouldn't be able to be played on turn 4. So I like the decision.
Okay. So
Mire Keeper? Nah, not really. You don't have a good follow-up. Unless you go Mire Keeper for a 3-3 and a 2-2.
So every time somebody does that, it seems like for this situation where you're trying to, you decide you've got to fight for the board, every time that happens, it doesn't seem to work. Yeah. I'm not saying he can't do that. It might be the right play and he may have to, but if you're in that much of a mess where your Mire Keeper now has to fight for board, you usually end up losing anyway, I think.
Okay, now it's an interesting situation for JJ. Does he play the 7-7 or does he use the Lightning Bolt and just Totem Golem? But if he uses Lightning Bolt and Totem Golem, that he cannot develop the 7-7 next turn. I feel like developing 7-7 on turn 4 is just so problematic for the Druid to deal with and just go with it every single time. But at the same time, the Anomaly is actually an insane minion in this matchup. So if you save it, then still not bad. Right?
So you've been in the later stages of these big tournaments. When you're there, will JJ have found out, because then they're not being told each other deck list, will somebody have told JJ, Azkaka's playing like crazy big ramp Druid, will he know? Because he's not seen anything yet that gives that away.
I don't think he knows right now.
But will somebody have let him know somewhere? Will he have found out somehow?
Well,
from opponents, from people watching, whatever.
Well, we didn't see... Wait, that's the second match for Azkaka, right?
Mm-hmm.
I feel like JJ probably knows.
Somebody will have found out for him. People seem to... Word gets around. He won't know the list, but he'll know the style he's up against.
Yeah, I would say he knows.
And now he's stealing the Sylvanas. That's another clue, anyway, that things may not be quite as they seem. Sylvanas is fine, obviously, normally, but...
Correct.
Just hit you in the face. Who cares, anyway?
Yeah, I like the decision. Like, when someone just plays Sylvanas, yeah, well, what do? Race him.
Sure, just
gonna
hit
that's
you.
How you win the game here. But by the way, double Feral Rage is also an interesting tech. He needs to play Fendral in this deck. I'm 100% sure he plays Fendral in this deck. So when you consider that, when you actually can play Fendral into double Feral Rage, 16 health and 8 attack just from 2 cards?
Yeah, that would be a definite way out for him right now, although he's got to survive this next turn. He's already looking down the barrel here.
So one Feral Rage can be an answer to the Totem Golem. You can also use the Wrath to kill something on the board and then go for the 50-50 with Sylvanas.
Yeah, I think...
Doesn't look like a great idea.
I mean, nothing looks like a great idea right now. He's in such a mess, he's got to find, you know, whatever means necessary to not die for a turn or two. Like you say, he'll be hoping for that Fandral into Feral Rages, and that could change the game if he gets there, but...
Goes for the 50-50. This is game-deciding moment. And he gets the 1-1. Whoops.
Yeah. And that's just it.
It was far-fetched, right? You have to use a Living Rose on your own Sylvanas to get a 50-50, to get the 7-7. It's a far-fetched plan for Azkaka. It didn't work out. You can't really blame anything here. It was a...
Yeah, if it worked out, he'd be in a really good position. Yeah. But if it hasn't worked out, then he is now almost certainly, unless there's some more crazy stuff in his deck, which there's not at this point, it's going to be 2-0 to JJ.
Interesting. I'm wondering... He didn't go with the Shaman versus Shaman, so he feels like his Shaman is not favored in the mirror mat, right?
That's interesting.
Felt that the druid is favorite with this kind of build.
That's interesting, because what shaman's not favored against face shaman? Like, face shaman's kind of, unless he's got a really, really greedy shaman, like a really heavy mid-range, that's the only one that's really not a favorite against aggro shaman for me. All the others are either the same or big favorite.
Yeah.
Unless he just thinks this druid beats it and he feels like he's had a bad draw, maybe. He didn't get an innovate, maybe. Didn't get a fan draw. Some of the key cards didn't turn up. Swipe.
Oh, it wasn't that horrible.
It wasn't that bad, though, right? Yeah, I agree. Yeah.
Interesting. Well, we'll have to see what is the third deck for Skarka, because the Shaman might be something else different, completely different, right?
Well, I mean, it could be a War Shaman, it could be a Witch Shaman, which some people have been playing. That's the one that I think it might be if he feels that he's weak to the aggro, because that one sometimes gets a little...
The Witch Doctor Shaman.
The deck of the week that we'll never have to see again going into next week with new cards.
Probably, right?
That's one week least, meta.
That's my impression of the deck, because I'm like not really convinced of it, you know?
Well, I agree with you. Like, have you ever thought about putting Violet Teacher in Shaman? Ever? In all the years you've played Hearthstone?
Well, it was a thing, like, a year and a half ago.
Okay,
yeah,
sure.
Yeah, but, you know...
So... Why everyone just jams it into tryout, which is fine, right? Try out those new cards. Enjoy the new cards while you can. Have fun with the game. But forget it next week.
Probably. So it's a, let's say, mirror for now, but it might not be a mirror. It's just Shaman versus Shaman.
And this is why Shaman is usually good against Shaman, because it's either a mirror against aggro Shaman. Mm-hmm. It's either a mirror where you're 50-50, or you have this mirror that then breaks in your favor when you start playing the big stuff and they run out. But it looks like a straight-up mirror to me.
Yeah, for now, it looks like that. JJ opens up the game with a really powerful Total Golem on turn 1, which can be then followed up by a 1-drop, which seems for the newer players unintuitive, right?
Yeah, because, definitely.
Well, you have Tunnel Truck, right? Why don't you play Tunnel Truck into then Total Golem that buffs up the Tunnel Truck? But the thing is, Shaman has many ways of dealing free damage to a minion, and that is Lightning Bolt, Rockbiter. If there's an Argus Coin on board, you have Abusive Sergeant, you have Flametongue Totems. That's 8 cards. 8 cards in a deck that has 25 cards left?
Yeah.
Wow, that's actually a lot
that's
of...
That's like 1 in 3. You probably got one.
Yeah, and he just steals a lot of tempo.
Right, so if you can get that Tunnel Trog down later, you're saying, if you get it on turn 3, turn 4... It might be slightly smaller, but it stays there.
Yeah.
And that's like we said before, the 2s and the 4s, they add up in this.
Agreed. It's a very powerful play and still leaves JJ in an uncomfortable position because he is on the back foot, because he was second during that game.
And he's just done the thing that you pointed out. He didn't want to go to the point where this takes 1 damage on his Totem Golem because of the 3, and you'll see exactly what you said. It just dies. He's got 3 health. It just doesn't live long. And like you say, he puts him right on the back foot, and we can see Oskarka's hand is just going to keep bringing the stuff. But JJ is not out of this. His hand is also really powerful.
True. And the problem is that Oskarka has a 7-7 on turn 4, but is it better than Flamedon Totem? It has to be. Flamedon Totem is really awkward because you have to use a hero power, but it will leave your Totem Golem alive, which is problematic for JJ.
It also makes next turn easier, where you can just keep playing hero power and maybe Tuskar. Mm-hmm. You don't play the 7-7, but
yeah,
but you keep that overload out of the way.
But not playing a 7-7 on 10-4 just feels bad every single time, right?
It does. But it's like credit cards. You go and buy the nice car, pay up, and then next week you sort of have to pay it all back and some more, so...
Yeah, I feel like the 7-7 is always correct.
But you're right, yeah, I mean, it's just going to now hammer home the damage. And JJ can deal with it, but it's going to take all of his resources to do so. And he even chooses just not to bother because it would have left him in such a bad place if he lava burst that.
Correct. Definitely just have to ignore it. Oh my god. So Pharaoh Spirit is there. Wow.
When you can hide your 7-7s behind taunts and then play another one just in case, you're probably winning that game of Hearthstone no matter what your opponent is.
Most likely. Oh, he actually... Wow, he trades.
Interesting.
Wow. Okay, so he values his Flaming Totem so much in the upcoming turn.
Mm-hmm. And also, he's got another one. I guess he's thinking, you know what, damage isn't a problem here. If I don't... The only way I lose this game is if I have an accident. And the only way I have an accident is if I let things stay on the board. So I've got another 7-7. Let's use this one to just tidy things up. Mm-hmm. Put my second 7-7 behind the taunts. And how does JJ deal with that? And the answer is he probably doesn't, although he's having a good look at a handful of good cards again.
This is really interesting. The problem with the fact that he played his Sir Finley is the result of his things from below not being cheaper than 4, unless he will get Tusker of Lemmings and another Torquen Golem.
And he hasn't had much time to use that hero power because he's been slightly behind the whole time. Mm-hmm. And so he's always been making minions just to make sure that the board is even challenged. Which it won't be for much longer. He's got to do something now. He's choosing to use that Lava Burst, which will, again, be that overload issue shortly.
But it has to be Mars and Portal this turn, right? It gives him a one drop, which might trade with the second Pharaoh Spirit. Second time anomaly? What is this anomaly?
Like, nice. Yeah.
Oh, I got such a weak pun, and you said
it's
nice.
Good.
Oh, come on.
Man, it's good. It's early in the day. We've got to warm up.
Arcane Anomaly, a new card from the new expansion from Karazhan. Seems like a reverse mana worm that is available to all classes. It's actually way more powerful than people were thinking that it is, right?
Yeah. Yeah, I've faced it in some bits and pieces that people have been testing it, and you have to deal with it, or it gets out of control really quickly.
Yeah. It's like a kind of like a Tunnel Trog as well.
Yeah. Yeah, a reverse any of those, Tunnel Trog, mm-hmm. Undertaker. For those who want flashbacks.
My god, Undertaker. So what do you do now? I feel like you need to play Tusker of the Mughal, though it's, inefficient. But it gives you additional damage next turn, which kind of can trade with 7-7.
And if you, yeah, he's just going for the...
That was from the finger below, so he values the mana efficiency more than the possibility of coming back with a Tusker of the Mughal. Because if you just roll Totem Golem here, it's a great opportunity to get back into the game.
I mean, his health total is still 27. He can kill that next turn by going down to 20. Mm-hmm. He does have time here, at least if Oskarka doesn't put another taunt in the way. He does have time to come back. This is a matchup where you can come from behind. It's not like Zoo versus Zoo, where it just rolls out of control when you get behind. But it's still kind of, he's still struggling. His card's down here.
What is the roll from Tusker of the Mughal? A healing totem.
That's a good roll, I think. Not necessarily for the next turn, but for the turn after.
It doesn't make a difference for now, because still there's free attack from the Doomhammer with the Druid Hero Power. Which is pretty damn sweet, if you ask me, because now you're able to dish out additional 8 damage.
And just pointing out, that decision was made on turn 1 or 2, early in the game with the Finley, and he hasn't used it until now, but this sort of situation's been on his mind the whole time with that decision.
Correct. I can't really remember what were the other options from the Finley.
I can't.
I think we didn't.
It was
see
a
it.
Long time ago.
Yeah. But Malice and Portal is the new card for Shaman decks. It seems to be very popular nowadays.
Yeah, I didn't like it when I first played it, but it just turns out that the number of times that extra one damage and obviously the one drop as well is just so helpful in that little tiny swing. And then that snowballs into a swing the next turn. And we haven't seen it this game, but we did see it in the game against the Freeze Mage. And yeah, JJ just couldn't quite get back on an equal footing there. He was just always that step behind.
I don't know the exact deck list from JJ, but I feel like if you're not running in Lightning Storm, you're probably not going to go.
Right, a lot of them won't run maybe one, but I suspect JJ's the sort of player who doesn't. He playtests with Crane, and they're not fans of tech cards in that group. Like, tech card's a wasted card is the philosophy a lot of the time.
So they want consistency in the deck.
Right, and if you put in tech cards, not so bad in tournaments, obviously, compared to ladder, but if you put in a tech card, then you're losing consistency. You get this card, you get Lightning Storm against 10-10s in Druid. It's like, this is a card that does nothing.
Yeah, well, the thing is, like, they probably switched the Lightning Storms for Milestone Portal because it's still aggressive, right? It puts a minion on board, and that's the thing. And now we'll see the Bane of Shamans, which is Zoo. That's my impression of how Shamans should feel against a Zoo. And it seems like a very good opening for both players.
Yeah, which usually favors the Zoo. The way that the Shaman tries to win this is those 7-7s. Like, the Zoo does struggle a little bit to deal with 7-7s, especially if they're behind taunts. But the reason that Zoo won't go away is because Shaman won't go away. If Shaman went away, I think Zoo would be a lot less played, but it's just a really strong matchup for the Zoo in general. It's the reason we've seen it since the dawn of Whispers, when Shaman became so powerful. People were just like, oh, then Zhu's the best deck because it beats Shaman and it's good anyway.
Yeah, correct. So would you go for the Flame Imp double drop on turn one? I would probably go for it because it's the Flame Imp is the best minion on turn one you can ever play. And especially when it's being behind the taunt, so to play around Flamekiln Totem or Abusive Sergeant.
Yeah, because you have that Abusive Sergeant, I think you do. If you don't have the Abusive Sergeant, I think you probably just take your time, get down the 2-4 on turn two.
Okay.
But I think with the Abusive Sergeant, I like getting it out there. For this sort of situation, now you can Abusive Sergeant, kill Finley if you want, or you can go the other way. So many nice ways. You've got nice clean trades anyway.
Fireblast is being chosen for Oskaka. Interesting, right? Because it plays around taunts, but is it better than Druid Hero Power, which also has the synergy with the Doomhammer and gives you some life points, right?
Yeah, it's interesting. It does, like you say, it does play around those taunts, and sometimes there can be a pain. But you've dealt with one of them. There's only two plus the defenders. So I like it. I think I like it. It's one damage is a lot of damage in this match. Everything's sort of small and fiddly, so one damage is more than it feels.
Alchem is doing work, heating the Flame Imp and still making it relevant for the board state.
Yeah, I mean, a 1-3 against this board is just the perfect shape, which is why we're seeing 1-3s in Finley and in the Murloc as well now, just sneaking into decks.
Yep. But it has to be the turn one, just drop Imp Gang Boss. On turn 4 is always powerful. It's awkward for Shamans to deal with because you need an entire packet of damage that will deal with the minion at one time, right? So it's most likely only 7-7 attack, a boosted up minion.
This feels so bad. You've got 5 damage that really wants to go to the face. You have to do it. You have to deal with a minion.
Mm-hmm.
And that's 2 more cards the Zoo can draw later and so on. It's a Flame Imp he can play without worrying.
Yeah.
All these things just add up in this matchup. And this is why it's so bad for the Shaman. The Shaman's had a good hand. He's made some good trades, he's in a good position, and he's still, look at this board, he's still miles behind.
And very important information for JJ, because of the fact that Finley changed the hero power, there's no possibility of air power totem into Milestone Portal, which would have been devastating in most of the situations against the Zoo, and now that's out of the way.
Right, and now he's just going to be able to ping one guy, which is...
horrible.
Yeah, that's also... Super JJ knows what's happening here.
Yeah, and he's like, yeah, I have
the
answer for that.
I have
this. I have this under control.
Not only that, I'm going to put down another 1-1 just to show you how much I don't care about your Maelstrom Portal. Like, get rid of this Divine Shield. I don't care.
Oh my
god!
Oh my god, what happened here?
So what's that playing around?
No, he's not playing around. That was just a misclick, I would say. JJ was visibly upset but what happened here, and... well, this doesn't happen often.
I mean, wow, that has to be a misclick. Like you say, JJ's... he knew what was in the hand. It was telegraphed. Like, there's no more bigger telegraph than pinging a super-health minion.
That was just something happened with him pointing on the wrong thing. I mean, it's not the time when Harson had the dancing minions.
I was going to say, dancing minions, or when you had some of these tournaments where people had to play for the first time. No one had ever used, like, an iPad or something
when
first promoted it. And people were, like, clicking all the way around the screen when they're going for lethal to make sure they don't misclick. That was just, like, a moment of...
I'll have to ask JJ after this game.
Yeah.
But it's interesting. Will it cost him the game? Might be the case, but it's still favourite.
It shouldn't, but it's made a huge difference. I mean, the game was in an unlosable position, and now we've got a game of Hearthstone again.
Look at this. If there will be another minion, that's still a huge advantage, but bear in mind, that minion would have been a knife juggler. That 2-1 could have been actually dead.
So could that opponent, I think, pretty much. And Oskaka's got to get himself together as well. Like, if your opponent does that, you've got to suddenly be like, oh my goodness, I've got
an opening.
And if anyone can get themselves together quickly, it's Oskaka, right? He's really, really cool.
Yeah.
But you've got to make sure that you don't overthinking.
That's a huge draw for JJ. Doomguard deals with the 5-5, deals a lot of damage to the face as well, because that's pushing 5. And Oskaka, what does he need? He needs a second Milestone Portal. Nope.
No, not good enough. And especially as he hasn't managed to push any face damage, which is why Zoo does well, because now the Zoo can just 2 cards for 1.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't mind taking the 2 damage because it's had such control the whole game. And two Zoo cards versus one Shaman card, there's only one winner most of the time anyway.
Yeah, even though Shaman now seems like he's in control, but as you said, the draw potential is just so big. Even though the draws from JJ will be low impact, most likely. Just some two attack minion, one HP minion, something like that, that can easily be dealt with the Fire Blast. He's still behind.
Okay, so Lama versus the start. Unfortunately, he...
Oh! Okay, that makes a difference.
So if you get some sort of...
That is actually now like very...
Rock Fighter or something?
That is game. Because that's 10, 15, 18, and ping. That's 19 damage.
So JJ's going to have to tap into lethal, or Oskark is going to have an out to take this to game 5.
Even without a good draw next turn, he still has an out just because he got the Taunt Totem from the Tusker Totemic right now. That's the only way to get a Taunt Totem with his hand.
Yeah, like you said earlier, he got rid of his totems. So yeah, that was the only way he's ever going to get Taunt. And
Soulfire from Pedro, also an out.
Ooh. Wow.
That is awkward.
And now JJ's got to do some serious math. Like, he's got to decide, you know, do I even want to tap at any point? So you probably won't get the chance.
The problem with the giant is, look at that, Lightning Storm. But when you play a giant on a board state like that, you probably won't have a chance to go the 8 damage to the face because of the fact that you have no good option to kill a 0-2 minion. What are the options? You basically can only Doomguard that down.
I'm just looking at Oskarka's damage. He's got 8 from the weapon. He's got 5 in hand. It's 13. He's got 3 from the minion. He's going to win this next turn.
Horrible situation for JJ. He needs a win right now. Two chances. First, Devil Alpha doesn't do anything. Tap into Forbidden Ritual. Oh, man.
And that's absolutely crazy. That is game to Oskarka. JJ, what looked like a misclick or something, or I don't know, a moment of craziness. It's got to be a misclick, you would think. Because it was so telegraphed what was going to happen. And
yeah,
a couple of bad draws from JJ, an incredible roll off the Tuskar for the Taunt, and we're 2-2.
That is an interesting, let's say, follow-up of what happened in the previous sense. JJ has to be heartbroken in this situation, right?
Yeah, now he's the one who's got to get himself together. Like, it's game, those things play on your mind, and the top players, it plays on their mind more because, you know, they're the top players, they're cool, they're calm, but something like that happens once in 1,000 games, once in 10,000 games.
Mm-hmm. Or on ladder.
Or on ladder where you just play another game.
And you don't really care much, right? But in tournament game, when you actually were winning the match to advance to the top 8.
Right.
And now there's a slight chance that you will lose the entire match, and then you have to play another match, and you can be knocked out.
Yeah, I mean, you have to play Zeros, who's just beaten Firebat. You don't want to play a guy who's just beaten Firebat your tournament life's on the line.
This doesn't look good for JJ. A Druid versus Shaman. If you don't get a good innovate...
Yeah, I agree. And the Shaman's got the hand here it wants, so... It's a very close matchup, I feel, but if you don't get the innovate, and the Shaman does get its stuff, and that's what's happening so far, could be good for Oskarka here. And you said you're going to ask JJ what happened. I'm going to keep well away when you do that.
Well,
I'm going to be on the other side of the room.
He will be nervous, but it's kind of interesting to me just to see what was the reason for that, you know? Was it a misclick? Was it a problem with the mouse?
Well, this start's at least going to give him some options, though. At least getting something on the board, he can buff, he can kill things. He's not going to die immediately, so Druid can just draw its way out of trouble. That mulch will help a little.
It's not terrible. Without that Living Roots, actually, that was crucial. Without that Living Roots, he would not be able to kill the Trog and maintain board control, which is now possible because of the fact that he had the buff. He has the Mulch, which is the answer to the biggest threat in your opponent's deck. So this is an amazing. And now without the Milestone Portal from Oskarka, it doesn't feel great. What do you do with this board position?
Right, and JJ, if he gets to turn 5, roughly level, we'll just pull ahead with those Azure Drakes.
Oh my god.
Wow.
You can play around Milestone Portal top deck now.
I mean, you've got the decision to make, right? You've got to think, would he have portaled last turn?
Yeah, he would.
Do I want to have 2 3-2s, or do I want to go have 7 power on the board? I think you just make 2 3-2s, personally, but you've got to at least think about it.
He went for the 3-2.
Okay. Puts an extra two. That puts an extra one health on the board, and he knows the two ones can't be dealt with now. Maybe he's thinking a three mana portal is not so bad because he's got nothing else to do.
If you would have just buffed the two minions, it would have been really awkward to deal with a Totem Golem example, right? That's also very important.
Yeah, we've said every game, like, the extra 1 point of anything in this match against Shaman is so huge.
Mm-hmm. Double
mulch. At least break points. And now you just mulch this.
Interesting.
People will be worried, hey, this mulch might give him something good, but he knows that Oskarka's got good things in his hand anyway. I mean, he gets a Boulder Fist, which is nice on curve.
It's just a tempo play, basically.
But he's got no time to play all these cards, is the problem. So it's no problem mulching to give him another card. He knows that if he can establish this board, he will probably get into this and hope to carry on with these Azure Drakes.
Yeah. So the question for Oskarka is, do I play the 7-7? His opponent used the mulch, and he used the mulch that was being top decked. So it doesn't really telegraph there's another answer to the 7-7. Because if the second mulch from the hand would have been used, then there's most likely another answer to the 7-7.
Right, but one of Oskarka's really strong points is his memory. And he will know that those three cards have been in JJ's hand for a while. Now, what cards sit in Druid's hand? So, Yogg, maybe Onyxia.
Oh, there's a lot of stuff, right?
Is there that many?
Ancient of Wars, Druid of the Claw.
Okay.
Azure
so, he probably won't. And second mulch is not necessarily always. Yeah, Arcane Giants. Yeah, okay. So, he will know that they've been there, but he can't really play around mulch. But.
Okay. Well. That 1-1 will deal with something, but now is the question, do you want to risk a Flaming Totem with Abusive Surgeon example, or double Flaming Totem to lose the Acid Drake? And I feel like that was the correct decision.
This board, in a minute, is going to go all-out war. Every minion is gigantic that's coming for like the next three or four turns. Yeah. Any minute now, this board is just going to explode into just huge stuff everywhere. And you know, Oskarka's just got a plan. He looks like he's got the better hand, but Druid will draw better than Shaman will draw.
I feel like this is the turn where you need to use Hero Power, play the 7-7 with the coin, because that gives you basically innervate for your Things from Below. He goes for double Things from Below. Interesting. Okay. I find it very interesting because the fact that a single swipe deals with the entire board.
Right. Yeah, that's... It's not there, but yeah, you're right. That would have been messy. On the other side, if he hasn't got the swipe, obviously one of the 5/5s is dying, but the other one just sits and lives.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
Oh, this is going to be so huge on both sides. Loving it. I love just watching these big guys smash each other in the face.
Why mulch? Okay. I have a good question here. Why do you choose mulch over the Rev, which deals 5 damage?
I'm looking at you, you're looking at me, I'm trying to work it out.
I mean, if he favors
it makes
the
sense. Maybe,
cycle
maybe
more.
The mana efficiency? Just maybe it's just that?
Well, it does matter with the Wrath next turn because you can play Arcane Giant.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's
what it has to be, right?
Yeah, it has to be that, yes.
Because otherwise the other play just looks so much better at first glance. It's like, but yeah, that's what it is. It's the mana efficiency we got there.
Yeah.
And then next turn he will get this giant down. But that's a good play, I like that. Working out exactly that this giant's exactly on 7.
True, and he will still get... Most likely that Thing from Below would trade with one of the Azure Drakes, so you will get a... cycle from the Wrath, which is important. But the problem is, there's a 6-7 on the board, but you have a bigger minion.
Yeah, it's just like a game of poker. Like, I see your 6-7, I raise you my 8-8. Mm-hmm. Every turn's been like for 4 turns, just... bigger and bigger things, and this Azure Drake somehow lived to come out the other side of all this.
Yeah, yeah.
This is all JJ's mulching and killing things. Actually, this Azure Drake, Oskarka's not had chance to get rid of it, and it's just actually a bit of a problem.
No, well, he has to go for the Flaming Totem. Oh my god, he
gets
it. This is a huge spawn for Oskarka.
It is.
Otherwise, he would not have the option actually to kill the 8-8.
And then drop his own 7-7, which then won't have an 8-8 to worry about.
Yeah, exactly.
Absolutely massive. Of course, there is the wild card in JJ's hand. Mm-hmm. Going back to poker analogies.
It's still far away, you know?
Still 3 turns. He's got to survive that long, and getting hit for 14 a turn. Oh.
My god, both players are going like in and out. Violet teaching to swipe is fantastic. kills the totem, sorry, the Tasker Totemic and the 7-7, creates a 1-1. Sick.
And all of those huge minions have cancelled each other out. We're left with just, you know, a teacher, a totem, all these massive guys that we thought were going to swing this game. They've just died. And, I mean, JJ's game now is about not taking damage and getting as much of a situation that helps him as possible before playing that Yogg. Because for all the memes, the Yogg still needs a setup. It's still, the more you can help your Yogg, the more it can help you.
Yep, correct. But that, this turn is really awkward for us, Kaka. I think I would actually go for the engineer, because that creates more minions on the board, which can deal with the board from the druid, because of the fact that the swipe was already
and
used.
You know there's no swipe because he just top decked the one to clear. Yep. And that's what he goes with, and another big board generated. So this is huge draw. What is
I
what
can,
is life?
I can't just wow.
Swipe the right minion, JJ.
Oh my god, this is like ridiculous. He just top take a swipe into a swipe. What a start. This is like dirty.
Yeah, like both players have been like playing around a top deck, and both players have been getting the top.
Oh my god. And look at that. He's able to play everything that he needs.
And from nowhere, JJ's just turned it right back around. And
then the problem
and now he won't want to play Yogg.
Yeah.
Now you just save the Yogg until you have to, because it can only hurt you at this point.
The only problem for Skak is the fact that he is at 13 life and he will be at 10.
So do you have to take the heal here just to help your minions along? And
oh, that was a tough decision. I mean, Dagger Mastery for sure, just it's bad.
Yeah.
Really bad. But Steady Shot and Lesser Heal, both are really asymmetric when it comes to the outcome. But I feel like the heal might be more important. Yeah, whoa, my god!
Wow.
Okay, now it's definitely better. Unless your opponent will kill the Light Warden, right? But
do you think he should have done the portal first before deciding his Finley?
I think so.
In
hindsight,
you got lucky that way, but it wouldn't have mattered. But
yeah. I think so.
I would say he got lucky. He's going to lose, so it's not helped him at all. But it's like.
Yeah, but it is funny when you see those outcomes.
And JJ finally allowing himself to start picking his notes up. He's finally going to get there.
Wow, that's kind of BM from JJ.
And now it's safe to ask him again what happened in game four.
Yeah, yeah. But wow, it should have been a 3-1.
Yeah, JJ threw to the top eight. And Oskarka versus Zires, again, that'll be another good match later today.
True that. Oskarka was on the brink of winning that game because of the fact that JJ will misclick. What do you think about Raven the Dead?
Yeah, it was it's kind of crazy just how dead set, like you guys were saying, you know, like JJ just pretty much won the game. He just plays the Argus and everything goes right, and then just must have been a misclick or something went wrong for JJ somewhere, and it did cost him the game. But I think for that series as well, just the power of Aggro Shaman, you see, you know, like just demolishing. We've seen it in multiple Last Hero Standing format tournaments where Aggro Shaman is just like almost the number one sweeper deck. I know we've seen Druid perform, you know, well, at least today, all right? But Aggro Shaman is just brutal, like almost the extent where people maybe should consider banning Warrior. But we did see JJ had the Zoo lined up ready to counterpick, which is something that, you know, the big factor in Last Hero Standing, right?
Yeah, that's correct. But still, we have seen Zoo losing to a Shaman, which shouldn't happen, at least in this case.
Right.
But it can happen it's still like a 60-40 matchup, maybe 65.
Yeah, maybe not even that. Like, you know, a thing like Zoo's like one of the best matchups to play against it, but it doesn't mean like Zoo just crushes it every time. Like, especially when we see, I think Oskaka was running Lightning Storm, right?
Yeah.
So like that changes everything. Board. Yeah, exactly. So you can actually clear up the board. But I think we do actually have the bracket for this group ready, so we can actually see what is happening so far today. As we are now done with the second match, and JJ is going to go through to the top eight. So there we go. We see JJ in the sort of winner's spot there. And the match coming up later on is going to be Oskaka again versus Zires to go for that second place spot for the top eight. So Oskaka not out yet. He's still got a chance.
Yeah, and what I thought was interesting there was something that Lothar highlighted, which was he chose to pick the Druid into the Shaman rather than the mirror match.